Thank you. I agree, amen. Would you please pray with me for illumination? Turn us towards your radiant face, Lord. Unstop our ears, calm our minds, and settle our troubled hearts. Somehow, Lord, get our attention so that we will see your smile, know your heart, and truly fathom the depth of your love. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our first reading this morning is from 2 Kings chapter 2, verses 1 through 14. I added a couple verses to Dodie at the last minute. It's found on page 291 in your Pew Bibles, 2 Kings 2, 1 through 14. It's titled, Elijah Taken Up into Heaven. When the Lord was about to take Elijah up to heaven in a whirlwind, Elijah and Elisha were on their way from Gilgal. Elijah said to Elisha, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to Bethel." But Elisha said, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went down to Bethel. The company of the prophets at Bethel came out to Elisha and asked, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," Elisha replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, Elisha, the Lord has sent me to Jericho." And he said, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So they went to Jericho. The company of the prophets at Jericho went up to Elisha and asked him, "Do you know that the Lord is going to take your master from you today?" "Yes, I know," he replied, "so be quiet." Then Elijah said to him, "Stay here, the Lord has sent me to the Jordan." And he replied, "As surely as the Lord lives and as you live, I will not leave you." So the two of them walked on. 50 men from the company of the prophets went and stood at a distance, facing the place where Elijah and Elisha had stopped at the Jordan. Elijah took his cloak, rolled it up, and struck the water with it. The water divided to the right and to the left, and the two of them crossed over on dry ground. When they had crossed, Elijah said to Elisha, "Tell me, what can I do for you before I'm taken from you?" "Let me inherit a double portion of your spirit," Elisha replied. "You've asked a difficult thing," Elijah said. "Yet, if you see me when I am taken from you, it will be yours. Otherwise, it will not." As they were walking along and talking together, suddenly a chariot of fire and horses of fire appeared and separated the two of them, and Elijah went up to heaven in a whirlwind. Elisha saw this and cried out, my father, the chariots and horsemen of Israel." And Elisha saw him no more. Then he took hold of his garment and tore it in two. Elisha then picked up Elijah's cloak that had fallen from him and went and stood on the bank of the Jordan. He took the cloak that had fallen from Elijah and struck the water with it. "Where now is the Lord, the God of Elijah?" he asked. When he struck the water, it divided to the right and to the left, and he crossed over. Our second lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Mark. It's Mark chapter 9, verses 2 through 9. It's found on page 820 in your Pew Bible. It's titled, The Transfiguration, Mark 9, 2. After 6 days, Jesus took Peter, James, and John with him and led them up a high mountain where they were all alone. There he was transfigured before them. His clothes became dazzling white, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. And there appeared before them Elijah and Moses, who were talking with Jesus. Peter said to Jesus, "Rabbi, it is good for us to be here. Let us put up 3 shelters, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah." He did not know what to say. They were so frightened. Then a cloud appeared and covered them, and a voice came from the cloud, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." Suddenly, when they looked around, they no longer saw anyone with them except Jesus. as they were coming down the mountain, Jesus gave them orders not to tell anyone what they had seen until the Son of Man had risen from the dead. I heard a devotional years ago. I think it was at an elders meeting, and I think it was Sarah Esper who shared it. It went something like this. Suppose that you're an extra in a Hollywood movie. You know, one of those momentary parts where you're somewhere in the crowd or in the background of one particular scene when the camera quickly flashes past. You would probably scrutinize that scene when you saw it, wouldn't you? In fact, every time you saw it, you'd watch that one scene over and over again where hundreds of people are milling around just waiting for that 2/5 of a second when you can see the back of your head. Maybe your family would too. Maybe your closest friends. Maybe. But no one else would get excited about your 2/5 of a second, would they? They probably wouldn't even realize that it was you. Even if you told them, most people wouldn't care. So how could you then ever think that movie was about you? Today is Transfiguration Sunday. Today we wrap up the season of Epiphany in the church. And today, both of our texts tell us about Epiphanies. There's a lot going on in case you didn't notice. An epiphany, if you recall, is an aha moment. It's when we get it. It's when we see the truth, often in a dramatic way, when we notice the true star of the story. An epiphany is a glimpse of God, the whole point of creation. And I'm wondering if we might see ourselves as an extra in one particular scene 2/5 of a second long. In our gospel lesson, Mark tells us of Jesus going up onto a mountain and standing in the presence of God. There, his appearances change, but more importantly, his true identity is revealed. The disciples look on in awe. I'm sure we would too. And Peter tries to find something to do. That may sound familiar as well. And in our Old Testament lesson, approximately 900 years earlier, Elisha watches as his mentor, Elijah, is taken up into heaven in a whirlwind, riding in a chariot of fire, drawn by horses of fire. Imagine what an experience like that would have been like. What would you do if you were there? In either place. Or better yet, afterwards. I mean, God's power, God's presence has been dramatically revealed right before your eyes. The star of the movie steps onto center stage just as the curtain goes up. What would that be like? I love epiphanies. And my absolute favorite description for one is God momentarily piercing the veil that separates heaven and earth. So what's it like to briefly peer through the veil and stand in the presence of God? Have you ever done that? You ever been touched by the divine, experienced the Lord's majesty and awe firsthand? How should one respond to an experience like that? Elisha watched as his mentor, Elijah, rolled up his cloak and struck the waters of the Jordan River, parting them to the left and the right, just like Moses did the Red Sea. Then this prophetic protege watched, along with 50 other prophets, as Elijah was taken up into glory right before his eyes. What would you do with that? If you were one of the 50 prophets, an extra, what would you do? We're told that Elisha tore his clothes, presumably in grief over the loss of his mentor. But then it says Elisha picked up Elijah's cloak, the very one that Elijah had used to part the waters. And then Elisha did the very same thing. Does that address the question? After witnessing the glory of God, and or even seeing the glory of God shining through someone else, what's the next step? Jesus took Peter and James and John up on a mountain to pray. These are three of the first disciples called by the Lord, remember? These are the same three Jesus took with him into the Garden of Gethsemane to pray on the night that he was betrayed. These are the same three who fell asleep while they were there. They're players in the drama, to be sure, but certainly not perfect, are they? So try to imagine being there. Right before their eyes, their teacher, their counselor, their spiritual leader is changed, transformed. He becomes radiant. His clothes become dazzling white, it says in the NIV, whiter than anyone in the world could bleach them. Then Jesus speaks with Moses and Elijah face to face, two lifelong biblical greats, after which a loud booming voice comes thundering out of a cloud, proclaiming just who Jesus really is. "This is my son," says God. Listen to him. What'd you do with that? I've heard a moment like that described as a Wizard of Oz moment. I'm not sure if I like that description or not, but it does create a word picture. Here we are, mere mortals, standing in the Gothic hallways of the Emerald City, where we're greeted with an explosion and great billows of smoke. A giant, disembodied, sometimes menacing voice echoes, "I am Oz, the great and terrible. Who are you?" So what would you do? Would you attempt to respond like Dorothy and chance being silenced? Or would you approach with caution like the Tin Man or the Scarecrow, filled with trepidation, wondering if the gifts that you seek will be bestowed upon you? Or might it take everything you've got to simply not faint in fear like the cowardly lion? Epiphanies can be overwhelming, you know. Truly awe-filled moments. Moments when Almighty God reaches through the veil that separates us and touches our heart. And then afterwards, the ball's in your court. I know some of you have had moments like these, so think back. Maybe you all have. I mean, you're here, right? So at some point, your spirit has been touched by God's Spirit. You experienced holiness firsthand. You were given a glimpse of the majesty of God, witnessed the divine. You were there on the mountain or maybe on a gentle knoll. You saw the chariot fade away into the clouds or felt the Holy Spirit descend gently like a dove. And it was a gift too, a beautiful gift. But now what do you do with that? I mean, it's not about the moment, is it? No matter how powerful that moment might be, it's about the narrative, the entire storyline, all that happens before that moment, and especially all that happens after. This movie, this grand drama unfolding over time is not about you. And yet, you play a role. An epiphany can be scary, believe me, I know. And maybe it should be. You might respond like Isaiah or Jeremiah. Your knees may begin to knock. You might cry out, "I'm just a child, Lord. I don't know how to speak. Woe is me, I'm ruined. I'm a man or woman of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And yet my eyes have seen the King. The Lord Almighty." Or maybe instead you turn inward, you know, like an extra in a movie, shining the spotlight solely on yourself. Or maybe your response will be something else entirely, but over time, as the smoke clears and the dust settles, and you realize that moment was actually an epiphany from God, as you ever so slowly become aware of His presence with you, then what? Epiphanies come in all shapes and sizes, don't they? They happen on grand scales and in a small, quiet whisper. They happen all the time, actually. The question is, are we being still enough to hear? So how often would you say in an average week you become acutely aware of the presence of God? Does that correlate in any way with how intentional you are in setting aside time and creating space for that to happen? How are you at removing the distractions and simply turning your eyes towards heaven? I'm going to assume that becoming aware of God's presence happens at prayer for you and that you pray often. I'm going to assume that it periodically happens at worship as well and that you worship each and every week. But in addition to those disciplined, intentional times, and apart from all those fearful times when life has you backed into a corner and you turn to God as a last resort, apart from those, how God aware do you think you really are? It's a good question, isn't it? One we should ask ourselves all the time. A little unsettling, maybe, or at the very least reflective. But if it's not enough to make you stop and think, then how about this? How God aware are the people around you based on what they see in you and through you? I mean, as a believer, you might just be an epiphany for someone else. Did you know that? On the way home from church, the little girl turned to her mom and said, "Mommy, the pastor said, God's bigger than we are. Is that true?" "Yes, honey, that's true." "He also said that God's living in our heart. Is that true too?" "Yes, honey, that's true too." Well, if God's bigger than we are and God's living in our heart, then shouldn't he shine through? You can see where I'm going, can't you? Are you an epiphany or not? Is your life an epiphany? God's clearly bigger than we are, even though we sometimes forget that or let our ego or our world or the enemy tell us differently. And the Holy Spirit is definitely living in our heart. That's a biblical promise. Once you've accepted Jesus as Lord and Savior and are baptized into his name, that's simply a given. So if that's the case, then shouldn't the Spirit of the Lord shine through you? Or at the very least, leak out around the edges. Once you've had an epiphany, been to the mountain, witnessed the chariot of fire ascend into the sky, once you've noticed the majesty of God in whatever way he happens to make it happen for you, what is the appropriate response? Paul, in his letter to the church in Galatia, suggests love and joy and peace and patience should radiate from your very being. Kindness and goodness and faithfulness will flow freely from the depths of your soul, and gentleness and self-control will simply gush forth. And in his letter to the Colossians, he adds, compassion and humility will be the norm. Let peace rule in your hearts, he says. And Paul started out as a sinner, remember, separated from Jesus. He actually persecuted Christians prior to his conversion, had them put to death. But then, on the Damascus Road, he had an epiphany. So you tell me, as extras in the movie, doesn't part of our role include being an epiphany for others? Aren't we instructed by the director to let our faith shine in the twinkling of our eyes and dance on the turn of our smile? Isn't the opposite of that making people search to just find a spark? Jesus takes Peter and John and James up onto a mountain, and there, filled with the Holy Spirit, the glory of God shines through him. In that instance, the veil obscuring our Lord's true identity is pulled aside. Who he is and whose he is clearly revealed. And at the same time, the curtain of doubt for Peter and the boys is suddenly withdrawn, briefly, maybe, but in an extraordinary way. Physically, Jesus' clothes become shimmering white, more amazing than we could ever explain. Spiritually, his true nature is revealed, and a powerful, commanding voice declares from heaven, "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." It is the same voice, mind you, saying the very same thing that it did at Jesus' baptism. "This is my son, whom I love. Listen to him." And for most of us, that would have been enough to get our attention, don't you think? I know it would have been for me. But then, like theological icing on an ontological or existential cake, two of the greatest religious figures of all time appear on the stage, and Peter, in shock, maybe most certainly in awe, starts stumbling over his words, probably same thing we might do. "Lord, should I set up a few tents? I sure am glad we're here to help." These are good Jewish boys, remember? They would have known the scriptures quite well. The implication, the echoes, would have been very clear to them. Moses is the great lawgiver who took three people with him up on Mount Sinai to get the commandments. There, God spoke to him from a cloud, and Moses' face became radiant from his encounter with God. In fact, after meeting with God, he had to wear a veil, if you recall. A grand drama is unfolding right before them, one clearly designed to point to the Almighty. And with Moses stands Elijah, arguably one of the greatest prophets of all time. Right in front of them, as Jesus is transfigured, are the very cornerstones of their faith, the law and the prophets. So if you were there in the crowd or on that stage, or as you stand on a smaller one, maybe, cast as an extra in the movie, what role do you play? What role should you play? Consider that for a moment. You're at the gates of the Emerald City. You've seen waters parted and the glory of God shining on Jesus' face. You have mentors and leaders and teachers that have guided you along the way. So now, what is your role in the grand drama? Where is your mantle that you need to pick up and carry? Are you a star? Maybe a voice of proclamation, echoing the voice that rains down from heaven? Are you a Moses or an Elijah espousing the law or sharing prophecy? Are you more like one of the disciples, a tin man or a scarecrow, frightened by the magnitude of what you see, yet willing to step up anyway? Maybe you're ready to faint even like the cowardly lion, but you don't. Maybe you're like Peter. Bit confused right now, but feeling as if you need to do something. Tell me, Rabbi, what should I do? Can you relate to any of these biblical heroes or to a different one, maybe? I mean, you've spent time in the wilderness like some, right? You've helped point others to the Lord like some. You've been a leader at times and a follower at others. You've shown folks the lay of the land, helped guide others on the journey. You've been there, right? Stood where Jesus is standing, at least momentarily and metaphorically. You've been dramatically changed by the presence of Almighty God, haven't you? Something powerful happened between you and the Lord at some point. And now that your transformation clearly shows, I mean, it does, right? On your face, in your actions, with your words, I have to tell you, I find the exchange between Peter and Jesus kind of interesting. Telling, maybe. Just 6 days prior to that mountaintop, Peter realizes the truth and makes what we call the good confession. He publicly proclaims that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God. But now, in the midst of all that's happening, less than a week later, Peter calls Jesus Rabbi and teacher instead of Lord. Why is that? Could it imply that divine revelation is sometimes a process? And that we might slip backwards at times. And I love the exchange between Elijah and Elisha too. Elijah asks his protege what he can do for him before he's taken away. And Elisha, like the eldest son in any Jewish family, asks for a double portion of his inheritance. He wants to do what Elijah did and be who Elijah is. He doesn't want twice as much stuff. He wants to be Elijah's heir, wants to carry on the family name, he says, in essence. I want to carry your mantle. I want to be your legacy when you're gone. God's movie includes equipping the saints, doesn't it? But it also clearly mandates that we take on our own role in the drama and do so with gusto. So here's the thing, at least for me. Here's my final question to you this morning, as well as to myself, one I ask myself on a constant basis. Do my encounters with the Lord radiate on my face? Do my moments in the presence show for all to see? Since I've confronted the glory of God, because I've seen the veil of heaven momentarily pierced, pulled aside by the Lord himself, am I witnessing to that with my presence in the world? I certainly don't need to wear a veil like Moses did after his encounter with the Lord. Maybe just for a while, a COVID mask. But in all honesty, if God's bigger than me and living within me, then shouldn't he show? And all of God's people said, amen. Amen. I invite you to listen for the Holy Spirit nudging your hearts as we sing. And if you feel so moved to make a confession of faith or to reaffirm one you've made earlier in your life, or if you would simply like to join membership with this body of believers, please come forward as we sing. Will you stand?
Lifting up our hands and singing, holy, you alone are worthy.
Each week we come together as a family of God. We share with one another our joys and our concerns and lift them up before the Lord in prayer. As I said before, we will stop in the middle of this prayer and pause for a moment so we can lift up verbally the names of anybody that we would like to place before the altar of grace. Will you please join me in silent prayer? Reveal yourself to us, Lord. Help us to notice your glory. We know that it surrounds us and we see it every day. We see it sparkling in the tree branches and notice it in the pastel sky. We hear it in a newborn's cry and smell it on a warm spring morning. And we sense it here, Lord, in your house of worship, among your people as we gather for prayer. But open our eyes a bit wider, please. Thank you for being the Lord of our lives. Thank you for reaching out to us even when we don't think we need a hand. And thank you, Lord, for your promise of salvation through your Son, Jesus Christ. That revelation alone brings us to our knees in awe. So, Lord, we entrust all that we do and all that we are and all that we will ever become into your loving care with that promise. We open up ourselves, our lives, and our hearts willingly right now, placing our future into your hands. We also place the life of our loved ones into your compassionate arms, Lord, for we know of your grace. We've seen your love, and we are aware of your great desire to heal. Father, please bless those who we've been praying for these past few weeks. And please touch each person whose name is on our prayer list in powerful ways. Shower them with your love, Lord, and your peace and your joy. Pour it out on all those whose troubles are on our minds this morning, on each one whose health and safety and welfare are tugging at our hearts right now, and on those we're not even aware of. And please, Lord, rejoice with those who rejoice, for you are the God of all things. Father, we especially ask for your presence with Sarah Esper's dad, Mark, and with the family and friends of Dave Harden, with Yvonne Hockett's uncle, Wayne Kelsey, and Bonnie Williams' sisters, Jamie, and her husband, Bob, and Joanne. And also with those who are on our hearts here now, Lord.
All those that can't be with us today. Lord, I praise you for the gift of your Holy Spirit. I praise you for the grace, the love, and the mercy that you show us every day. And I praise you for Epiphany.
Pour out your grace on each of these lives, Lord. The ones we've lifted up before you today and the ones that are silently on our hearts. Pour it out on this church and on your world. For we ask these things in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we pray together now the very prayer that he has taught to us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. We're told in Acts that the disciples met together on the first day of the week to worship and break bread together. It's important that as we start our week, we come together as a family, we share in worship, and we break bread with the Lord. This is a family table.
Let us pray. Oh, holy God, we come to this table and we often recognize with our mind the gift that you gave us through the death of your Son, Jesus Christ, and what that means for us. But today, Lord, please give us an epiphany. Let it go from our minds to our hearts. Let us recognize with everything in it what it is to be loved by you. As John said, how great is the love of the Father has lavished on us that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. Let us live and move and find our being and share your love through that power and that love. Amen.
Prayed, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, and he said, take, eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Likewise, after supper, he took a cup, and after praying for this, he gave this to his disciples, and he said, drink of this, all of you. This is the cup of the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for the forgiveness of sin. These things do in remembrance of me. Would you please stand for our benediction? Today's benediction comes from 2 Corinthians 13, verses 11 and following. Brothers and sisters, rejoice. Strive for full restoration. Encourage one another. Be of one mind. Live in peace. And the God of love and peace will be with you. Amen.